turn your Bibles to James, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, and stand for the reading of the Lord. Wanted to also make sure that we emphasized to our youth that our very own Pastor Pelt in the bulletin has a segment entitled Choices and Their Consequences, that we will do well to take into consideration those things that he has wrote to inspire and encourage us. Amen. Amen. And I believe that the following message today speaks a great deal to the things that we say and the consequences behind the words that we use. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. James chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, read as such. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle his whole body. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot, that is key, directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a fire or how great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. A world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. Ooh. Wow. I want to speak to you today and for the next 2 weeks on the subject of taming the tongue. Taming the tongue. Taming the tongue. Man, you are sorry. I don't even know why the university wasted a full athletic scholarship on you. You ought to pack up your bags and go back to your hometown of Tampa, Florida. The following words were spoken to me by a football teammate 13 years ago during my freshman year in junior college. And when I heard these words, I immediately retaliated with my own hurtful words, trying to get a sense of comfort. And that if I could just get back at him and equally match what he has said to me, I know that I will come out on top. Although it made me feel good at the time and temporarily to sling hurtful words back at my teammate, the damage had already been done. My confidence and self-worth temporarily as a collegiate athlete had been destroyed by the nuclear bombs that dropped from my teammate's mouth. Indeed, the saying sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me, could not be further from the truth. Because broken bones in time will heal much quicker than a broken spirit that has been shattered by painful and negative words. Think about it. Does your mind still cling to the memory of someone who you admire? Who you trusted, who you look up to, slamming the door shut on your dreams of becoming a doctor, a movie director, or a CEO, all because they spoke words of doubt and discouragement and told you that you wasn't smart enough, told you that you didn't have what it takes in order to accomplish your dreams and accomplish your goals. Whatever the case may be, most of us in here right now can identify with what it means to be on the receiving end or having somebody use destructive and negative words. to rip us apart. And if we were to be honest,
yes, yes,
and exercise some humility,
yes,
we will keep it 100 and acknowledge that we too,
mm-hmm, all right,
have been on the giving end,
yeah,
oh, yeah,
of shooting out fiery darts,
yeah,
of hateful and bitter words,
yeah,
into the hearts and minds of other individuals. What is it about this 4-inch member that resides within the dark house of our mouths that creates so much chaos and destruction for us? In the following passage of scripture, the Apostle James gives us spiritual insight into the answer of this perplexing question. In fact, the entire book of James, which is actually one of my favorite books, gives us practical advice on how we as Christians can deal with a variety of issues. See, as you read the book of James, you find out, and it doesn't take long for one to discover, that James is concerned about Christian maturity. James is concerned about making sure that he calls the people to action. This is why James told the people. James said, hold on now. James said, be swift to hear and slow to speak. When James says, let us be doers of the word and not hearers only, he's calling the people to action. And the thing that we have to recognize as Christians and as believers is that God expects and he requires that we as children of God mature in our relationship with him. God does not expect for us to remain in a callow or immature state. God says, if you are my child and you are in my house, you need to abide by my rules and you need to look like me. To grow up spiritually, to stop crying over spilled milk and learn how to clean it up, to put down the bottle and pick up the fork and do what God has called us to do. James is encouraging the believers throughout his letter. And James in chapter 3 here, he opens up a subject, something that he wants us to understand is extremely important. And he talks about the power of the tongue. Now, James is not the first author in the scriptures who talks about the power and effectiveness of the tongue, but he is, however, the only author who has dedicated at least 10 verses of really dealing with this subject, because James wants the people to understand that when you know how and you learn how to control your tongue, you have reached a level of Christian maturity that God is pleased with. James began, when you look at verse 3, by saying or dealing with a subject or something that was subject that was going on in his faith community. James is concerned because many of the believers have positioned themselves and have stepped to the forefront within the congregation and have said that they want to be teachers. And James as a teacher himself, he encouraged the peoples and say, hold on now. Be mindful of wanting to get up and teach. Because James says what you need to understand is that those who have been called and who have been given the gift to teach are going to be held at a higher level of accountability when they stand before God. After James deals with this concern, he then moves to talking about what he really wants the people to understand concerning the subject of the tongue. In verse 2, James says, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle his whole body. Now the term in this verse does not mean, nor does it carry the idea that James is telling the people that one is sinless if they know how to control their tongue. That's not what James is saying, because this word in the Greek means fully equipped, full grown, or mature. So what James is saying is that when we learn how to control our tongue, we have reached a good level or a great level of maturity. And this is something, if truth be told, that many of us in here need to work on, because many of us, if truth be told, have a problem with our mouths. And you can take zestfully clean. You're not really clean unless you're zestfully clean and wash your mouth out for 3 hours. But if your heart is not right, if your heart is not clean, then your mouth is still gonna be foul. Sisters, that solicits a whole lot of amen. For when we say amen, it means that we stand in agreement. It means that we recognize that what the preacher is saying is right. But what I anticipate to hear is some people say, hold on, amen, you walking down my alley. But every now and then we need somebody to walk down our alley and to help us understand. Father's business. When James finally arrives at verses 3 through 6, he presses the gas pedal down to the floor and launches into a series of illustrations to drive home the point that he is trying to make, that words have a tremendous influence on our spiritual condition. Not only is James trying to convey to his original audience that our words have an enormous impact on our spiritual condition, but he also wants them to know that although the tongue is small in comparison to other parts of the body, it exercises a great deal of power. The first analogy that James uses is the analogy of a bit, B-I-T. And he's talking about a bit in relation to a horse. See, a bit is a metal instrument that goes into the mouth of a horse. And attached to that bit is a bridle, and those instruments work together to help the rider of the horse guide the horse in the direction that he wants the horse to go. A horse that stands 68 inches high and weighs over 1,200 pounds, and that's known as being one of the most strongest and stout animals in the animal kingdom, is controlled and guided by an instrument that is no more than 5.5 inches long. To further communicate his point, James launches into another analogy where he compares a rudder with a ship. All
right.
Now, James is a bad guy. And the reason I say he's bad, because see, James is my type of preacher. Because in the book of James, what we find is a book that is filled with nothing but practical illustrations that the people to whom he was writing can relate to. So when James talked about the bit and the horse, they understood what James was talking about. When he talked about the rudder and the ship, they knew what he was talking about. That this rudder, in comparison to the ship, and notice in the text that James draws attention to the fact that the ship is great in size.
All right.
Equally, he draws attention to the fact that although this ship is great, it is controlled and it is guided by an instrument that is much smaller and much insignificant, at least what most people would think, to other parts of the ship. That the helmsman of the ship, if he does not know how to use that rudder, When he finds himself in some dangerous and inclement weather, he can end up not only hurting himself, but he can hurt other folk. After using the illustration of the horse and the bit and the ship and the rudder, James finally makes the connection in verse 5 that he would like for his readers to consider, that although the tongue, which James uses as a reference for human speech, is small, it possesses a great deal of power. All right. And that like the bit and the riddle or the rudder, which determines the direction of the horse and the ship, our tongues too can determine the destination of our lives.
Amen.
I'm going to prove it. In Numbers chapter 14, this is the occasion in the Bible in which the ancient Israelites are standing at the gates of the promised land.
Yes, sir.
They had just received a negative report from some of the spies, a majority of the spies. When you look at Numbers, the beginning chapter, verse 14, listen to what the people say. It said that the people said, "Would that we have died in the land of Egypt, or would that we have died in this wilderness." What they are essentially saying is that you done drug us all the way from Egypt out here in this hot desert land for us to die. We could have died back in Egypt.
Right.
Or we could have died somewhere else in the desert.
Right.
Listen to how God responded to their words. God said, "As I live, declares the Lord, what you have said is in my hearing, and I will do to you what you have said. Your dead bodies shall fall in the wilderness, and all of you who have grumbled, who are at least 20 years and older, will not enter into the land which I have promised to your ancestors." Their words sealed their faith and became the casket that they had to lie down. I wonder how many of us have missed out on blessings that God intended for us to have, all because we could not control our mouth. Oh Lord, if you don't say amen, I know God is doing something. How many blessings have we forfeited? Deacon Anderson? Hey, what's up, John? What's going on, brother? Hey, look, man, John, hey, man, I have a wonderful job opportunity that I want to tell you about, man. It's a company that's currently hiring, and I heard that you are looking for a job, man. What you say about it? John. Man, I'm going to be honest with you, man. I done applied 120 times for different jobs. They not hiring in this market right now, and plus I really don't have the experience that most employers are looking for, so I'm not even going to waste my time applying. Boom! John has closed the door shut on a blessing that God could have intended for him to have, all because of his word spoken from his mouth. I wonder how many job opportunities have been closed off, all because of our words. There is power in words. There is. And the Bible declares so. Hebrews 13 or Hebrews 11 and 3 declares that by faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God. And God said, let there be light, and that which did not exist came into existence. And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creatures, and that which did not exist came into being. And God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. And because we are made in the image of God, we share certain attributes that God has, but they are modified, okay? No one in here, and if you do, let me please talk to you, but no one in here has the ability with their mouth to bring into existence organisms. I can't open my mouth and say, elephant, appear in Liberty Baptist Church. It's not going to happen. I can pray all day long. That is not going to happen. I do not possess that type of authority. And I don't think anybody in here possesses that type of authority. If you do, right now I need a new title. Say, Taya, please come into the sanctuary. Or just say, Taya, please appear in the parking lot and I'll meet you outside. And I'll even break you off, okay? But our words possess within them creative power, because our words can bring into reality certain things.
You preach it.
You can speak a word over your life concerning your health, and your health will line up. Do you understand what I'm saying? You can speak words of life over your finances, and your finances can line up. You can speak words of encouragement and life into the lives of others, and their lives will line up. This is why the writer in Proverbs 18 and 10 and 21 declares that death and life are in the power of the tongue. So I ask you this, my brothers and sisters, how many people have you executed with your razor sharp words? How many people have gone to an early grave all because they rubbed you the wrong way? How many people have you had to eulogize all because you could not, or we could not, control our tongues? Why? When we recognize the power of spoken words, I believe that we will become more conscious of what we say. And we won't just allow any and everything to come out of our mouth. Because Jesus said in Matthew 13 and 36 that on the day of judgment, everyone will give an account for every careless word spoken. And Jesus goes on to say that by your words, you will be justified and you will be condemned. Which means that not only are we going to have to stand before God on the day of judgment and give an account of our actions, God said you're going to have to give an account of everything that you said. Now, I don't know about you, but such a powerful, such a cogent word encourages me to make sure that I do what the psalmist writer said, that I guard my mouth with all diligence. Now that sounds good. Those are good words. You hear what I'm saying? James, after he makes the point that he's trying to make, because in those verses, or when he gives those illustrations, James is trying to show that small things have the ability to influence things that are great. Now, it amazes me how when I look at the animal kingdom, or look at the creatures that God has created, that the African elephant, as massive as it is, and as many deaths or fatalities that they are responsible for each year, The African elephant is not the most deadliest creature on earth. It's not the crocodile, not the lion, not the shark. The most deadliest creature in the world is the mosquito.
Come on, preacher. Come on now.
You want to run that by me one more time? The most deadliest creature in the world is the mosquito. Something that's so small, we don't think nothing about when it bite us, hit it, just. But the mosquito is responsible for transmitting over 700 million diseases into people's bodies. And between 2 to 3 million people die every year because of mosquito bites. Something that is small and that we might consider to be insignificant is extremely powerful. So after James makes his point that there's power in the tongue, James now moves to talking about how destructive the tongue is. And James doesn't hold any prisoners, because James says, how great is a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. Now up until this point, James is using the figure of speech that we know as a simile. He's comparing and talking about, he's comparing that the tongue is like the rudder to the ship. He's comparing how the bit and the horse. But now James just simply drops the simile. And James breaks out in verse 6 and said, the tongue is a fire. James just simply calls it like it is. James says the tongue is a fire. And I don't know about you, but when I think about fire, I do not get a pretty picture. I think about something that is destructive and something that is uncontrollable. Because when a fire, a small spark, is set, it has the ability to cause a whole forest to burn down. Oh boy, I wonder how many fires have we set with the words of our mouth.
All right.
How many friendships have gone up in flames? All because we could not control our tongue. How many people have been hospitalized with third and fourth degree burns? Because we scorch them with our words. My brothers and sisters, these things should not be. God has called all of us to not use our tongue, to not use our human speech in a negative manner, to slander one another, to lie on one another, to gossip about one another, to degrade one another, to belittle one another, to bash one another. God has not called us to do these things. These things are not of God. And James tells us in the text that it comes from the pit of hell. That the tongue.
Preaching is
dangerous. And the reason that the tongue is dangerous is not because the tongue in and of itself is bad. It's because of what sin has done to us. That sin has stained the whole body. And we have been affected. No matter how many hymns we sing, don't matter how many church services and activities we participate in, don't matter how hard you pray, or I pray, the one thing that we must never forget is that when we accepted Christ into our life, the blood washed away our sins.
Yeah. Yeah.
The scripture says that in whom we have redemption, even the forgiveness of sin. The blood has washed away our sins. This is why we sing the song. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood. The blood has washed away our sins. But the way that God has set this up in his divine plan is that we still have the sinful nature within us. And it's not going to go anywhere until Christ comes back and takes us on to glory. But until that happens, God has called us to make sure that we use our tongues in a holy and righteous manner. See, the tongue can be used for praying, for sharing our faith, for expressing gratitude, for telling the truth, for admitting a mistake, for apologizing, for confessing our faults, for reciting scripture, for encouraging one another.
That's right.
And God is saying, my people need to learn how to tame their tongue. God is saying, but before they can come to me, because I am the one who can assist them in taming their tongue, they first have to recognize the power of the tongue to speak life and death, to create certain realities, but they also need to recognize the destructive nature of the tongue. I dare you, as we stand to our feet, I dare you, in fact, I double dare you, starting today, for this whole week, I dare you to intentionally use your tongue for righteousness. I dare you to speak words of life into the lives of people who you come in contact with. When you at your job, because we know a whole lot of gossip go down at the job. I dare you, while the gossiping is going on, to step in the middle of that conversation and become the fire extinguisher and speak words of life and encouragement. The power of life and death is in the tongue. God has called us to recognize the power of the tongue. And next week when we come back, we gonna deal with how can we, as believers in Christ, really grab a hold of this thing and tame our tongue. But today's message was simply just a setup. You know, in volleyball, they call it, you know, you set your opponent up so when the ball is in the air, you can come through and jump on up there and boom, spike it down. The setup is this. Let us be mindful of the power of our tongues. And let us be mindful that how destructive our tongues can be. Let us be mindful that we can speak words of life. And let us be mindful that God has called us to walk in holiness. Amen.